Good evening, Rabotai. Tonight we're going to talk about one of the great mitzvot of the Torah, which is Kibud Av V'Em, honoring your father and mother. Where do we find that? In the Ten Commandments, right? Kaved et avicha ve'imecha. Which commandment is that, by the way?
Fifth
commandment, exactly. Right? So what does it tell you about in the Chumash regarding honoring your parents? And if you honor them, you're going to have a longevity, right? Long life. This is what it tells you. So, always the Chazal say, when you hear something like that, that a certain mitzvah is going to give you a long life, that also means the opposite. You can infer also the opposite. What does that mean? If you don't, so lo aleinu, it's going to also shorten the life. You understand? It always works both ways, these kinds of things. So, because of that, a person has to be very, very careful about how he treats his parents. Shulchan Aruch talks in Yordea about this mitzvah, how important it is. But there's also another mitzvah, which is Mora Av V'Em. As the Pasuk says, right? Ish imo ve'aviv tirau. Right? Exactly. So that's already a different mitzvah. Two different mitzvot involving the parents. One is honoring them, and one is Mora. What's Mora? What does that mean? Fearing them. So you actually have to fear your parents as well. What does that mean? You should think of them, you know what the poskim say regarding that. They say, you should think of them as some kind of a powerful king, you know, who can punish you, you know, if you don't behave properly, this kind of a thing. You have to be careful, because if they don't like the way you behave and they judge you, you know, with their thoughts or with their sayings, with their mouth, this can cause a big problem for a person, you know, this kind of thing. So a person has to be very, very careful about how he treats his parents because of this. Number one, right, let's see the Shulchan Aruch. This is in Siman Reish Mem, Ram Venisa, right? Reish Mem and Siman Shulchan Aruch. So the first thing the Shulchan Aruch tells us is, Tzarich lizaher me'od b'chvod aviv ve'imo u'moram. You have to be very careful about the honor of the parents and their fear. So one of the things a person has to know regarding the honor of parents, one important detail, is, okay, let's say your father tells you, your mother tells you, do this for me, do that for me. So the question is, okay, but let's say it involves paying money, right? So let's say your father tells you, no, listen, go for me now to Florida and do something for me over there and come back. So the question is, okay, fine, you're going to go because your father told you to do it. But who's going to pay for the plane fare? Who's going to pay for the cab? Right, exactly, that's the idea. So according to the halakha, right, the Gemara says that when it comes to honoring the parents, the bill is paid by the father, not by the son. So you tell your father, listen, you want me to go to Florida, right? Okay, but you're going to pay, right? You're going to buy me the airline ticket? Let me get your credit card. Right, so you can book me a flight, you know, right, back and forth. Right, the two-way flight. That's the idea. That's the way it is. Right, exactly. Whatever it is. So a person can ask his father and say, listen, no, it's going to cost me money. Even let's say, for instance, the father tells him, go to Staten Island. You know what I mean? Go to Staten Island. I need you to do me an errand over there. So you tell him, okay, but who's going to pay for the bridge? You're going to pay, right? The toll.
The son can afford it.
Huh?
The son doesn't need the father's money.
Right. Even if he doesn't need it, still he's not obligated to pay for that. You know what I mean? He could, if he wants, he could do it. That's something else. As a form of tzedakah, you know, something like that. But he's not obligated to do it. But the truth is, you know, I did find in the Zohar Kadosh, he says over there that you should pay for it, you know, if your father tells you to do something. So according to Kabbalah, it seems like it's a little bit different. That a person really should pay for honoring his parents. But according to halakha, it's not like that. So how do we do? What's the halakha? Do we go like the Kabbalah? Do we go like the Poskim? Do we go like the Gemara? So the truth is, we go like the Gemara, right? Every time that there's a machloket between the Kabbalah and the Gemara, the halacha is like the Gemara, like the Shulchan Aruch, and this is what we do. So therefore, the rule is, according to halacha, that you're not obligated to pay for honoring your parents, so they should pay for it, but if a person wants to be machmir, like the Kabbalah, like the Zohar Kadosh, and pay for it, tavo alav bracha, right? You'll give a blessing for that. That's the idea. So, important to know that. Okay, very good. That's the idea. Let's go on, right, a little bit. And it says like this. Now, it tells you, Shulchan Aruch, okay, regarding the issue of Mora, what does it mean to have fear from your parents? How do you display that, practically speaking?
Because you're afraid more than the father.
Right.
You have to respect the father.
How do you split it? How does that come to fruition? So it says the Shulchan Aruch like this, right? It says, Lo yamod bimkomo ameuchad lo. Don't stand in a place which is designated for him. Don't stand over there. That place is for him to stand there. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Certain place. Let's say in the synagogue, you know, for instance. He prays over there. Don't say, why are you standing over there? It's not for you, that's for your father. You know what I mean? That place. That's the idea. Or at home also, same thing, right? At home, let's say, he likes to pray in a certain place over there, to study in a certain place. So you go and stand there. You know, you're taking your father's place. Not right to do that, right? That's a moran. This is fearing your grandparents. Another thing is, right, also let's say he's hanging around there with his friends, you know, having like a discussion. You jump in over there, you know, oh, hi, how are you? You know, how's everything? You start to talking with them. What is this business? You know, this is your friends. This is your friend that you're talking to? This is your father. You know what I mean? So let him have his circles of friends that he talks with them. You don't have to go and get into that. This is not respectful to do that, right? It's disrespect. This is the idea. That's what the Shulchan was telling you, right?
What if he can't respect your father because he's not with you?
That's a very good question. Yeah, you know, the truth is that this question applies to many people. Many people don't live in the place where their father is or their mother is. So what do you do in a case like that? You should forgive him, that's for sure. The father should forgive. The son, there's nothing to forgive, right?
No,
the father has to forgive the son.
Forgiven.
You understand? The father has to forgive the son that the son is not honoring him.
Well, it's not the son's fault and he
still has to forgive him because Ozzy's obligated, right? That's the idea. But the idea is like this, if you live far away, the rule is that at least, you know, if you can't be there where your father is for some reason, let's say you have a job, you know, somewhere, you can't go there, or whatever it is, something like that. So what you should do is at the very least, call him up, say hello, how are you, you know, show that you care about him, right? Or go to visit him once in a while, you know what I mean? Go to visit, also to come to visit him. Well, you never go to visit your father, let's say he lives on the other continent, right? He lives in Europe, he lives in
Australia,
right? Lives in Israel, whatever. So what does that mean? But you shouldn't go and visit him. You should, if you can, you know, as we said, right? If you can do it. These kinds of things. Okay, whatever, you understand the point, right? But there's also another thing. When a person lives far away from his parents, there's also another thing that he can do. He can appoint a shliach to do what he has to do for his parents. So let's say that his parent is, you know, is old, doesn't feel good, sick, whatever it is. So he can't be there to take care of his parents. So he pays somebody, right, as a shliach, to go and do the job. That's what it says. Exactly, right? All kinds of things. Like, to bring him food, to bring him clothes, to bring all things that he needs, this kind of thing. Right? That's the way you got to do it. But they say, right, Adif oto mishlucho, right? It's better that he does it than the shliach. Okay. So if he can do it, it's better that he should do it. But if he can't, there's no choice, so then you can appoint a shliach to do. That's the idea, right? This is the way it works. But as we said, you're not really obligated to pay, you know? So the payment should come from, right, exactly, that's the idea. Very good. Okay. So, let's go on a little bit. As we said, right, that we said one thing is not to be in your father's place. To go over there and sit with them, with the people that are sitting with his friends, you know, joining them like that, you know, like you think you're like their equal, you know? What are you sitting there for? This is not your place, you know what I mean? You have to understand. That's like fearing your father. Or another thing is what? As we said, right, don't sit in a place where he sits over there. It's another thing. That's his place to sit, let's say, on a dinner table for Shabbat, right? Don't sit there. This is your father's place. You know? You have a different place. Sit over there. It's in your place. It's disrespect that you, right? Don't you sit
in... Even if he's not there, let's say 1 week he's on vacation.
Even if he's not there, really, the truth is you shouldn't sit there, you know, if he's going to come back. You know what I mean?
Rabbi's chair also.
If he's not going to come back, that's something else.
Rabbi's chair also.
You know, I mean, that's the idea.
Rabbi also.
Rabbi, yeah, also same thing with the rabbi as well, you know? Don't sit in this place.
Is your father also spiritual?
Yes. So let's go on, right? Let's go on a little bit. So he says, also another interesting thing is, very important thing, is that lo soteret debarav. Don't contradict his words, you know? Try to argue with him all the time. Give him a headache, you know, every day. No, I don't agree with you with this, I don't agree with you with that. You know, I don't agree with you, who's better, you know, Trump or Bloomberg, you know? Okay. What does it have to do with you? If your father likes Bloomberg, you know, it's not what's it to you, you know what I mean? Why do you have to argue with him about this? You know, all these kinds of things.
Nonsense.
Let him be whatever he wants to be. Don't argue with him. It's disrespect that you argue with your father. Like you're mistolichar, you know? Mistolich. You know, you're like, you're considered to be on the same level. It's disrespect. It's a chutzpah to do such a thing like that. That's the idea. Don't argue with him. ולא יקראנו בשמו. And also another thing, right? Not only you're not allowed to argue with him, also, but don't say, you know, I agree with you. What do you agree with me? What? Who are you to agree? You know, like what? You're on the same level as me that you agree with me? You know, same thing when you go to a chacham, you know, and tell him, I agree with you. What's it to agree with me? You are chacham that you agree with him? What's it there to agree, you know? You know something about that topic? Let's say a person is Amaris, right? Doesn't know nothing, you know? Not like you, you know? You know things, but I'm talking about people who don't know nothing. So you're going to the rabbi and says, I agree with you, rabbi. Well, I agree with you. What, you learn something about that? What's there to agree, you know? So also the same thing with your parents as well. Don't tell your father and mother, you know, I agree with you. Yeah, you're right. Who are you to tell me I'm right? Who are you? What, you know, it's disrespect. That's this kind of thing. That's the idea. Another thing is what? Lo yikra'enu bishmo. Don't call him by his name, you know? Say, oh, how are you, you know? How are you, Yochanan? You know, how are you feeling? Why are you calling him by his name? Disrespect. That shows that you think you are equal with him. This is not good, right? A person has to, how does he have to do? He has to call his father, you know, Abba, you know? All right, exactly, yeah, that's it, yeah. Idea. Don't call him by his name.
A lot of people, I respect them, they call him Mr. Sir.
Not yeah, very good, father. Very good. Yeah, that's the idea. So, to your father, you don't call him Mr., you know, that's not the proper thing. But you say Abba, you know, that's the idea, right? Avi Mori, right? Whatever it is, right? If you say Chacham, whatever it is, that's the idea. Okay, very good. So, you shouldn't call him by his name. Ela Omer, Abba Mari, right? Mori. Hayam Shem. Shem Aviv k'shem acherim. Let's say his father's name is the same as other people, right. The friends that he has.
Two Johnnies.
Right,
Johnny.
Yeah, right, exactly. So what do you do then? Let's say, you know? That's the idea. Meshane shemam im hu shem sheupeli. So he says, you know what? Change their name. It's something unique, a unique name. Shena kol regilim likobo. Not everybody calls by this name. It's a unique name. So in a case like that, you should change their name in order to not to call this name in front of your father, you know, there shouldn't be disrespect.
I call him a different name?
Exactly, right.
Which is...
Give him a nickname, you know? Yeah, whatever. That's the idea. Okay, whatever.
Mashiach.
Yeah, don't yeah, but not nicknames like Trump does, you know?
Hebrew nickname.
Mini Mike, you know, all kinds of things like
that. Hebrew nickname.
Don't call him names like that.
Okay.
Okay. You have to call him a respectful name. Okay, whatever. They don't say which is disrespectful. Very good. But says right there, Rama over here, that if it's something, a name which everybody knows this name, you know, let's say like Yehuda, you know, Moshe.
Uh-huh.
Right, so there, if he's not there, you're allowed to say. You know why? Because this is a famous name, everybody knows. Not everybody understands you're talking about your father. You're talking about your friend, let's say, or somebody else, you know? So if he's not there, you're allowed to say. That's the idea, right? Only if it's a name which is unique to your father, so there, you should never say it. Why? Because everybody knows you're talking about your father. That's the idea. Very good. So look what it says, right? That ad hechan mora'am. How far does the fear of the parents go? How far does it go? Haya ben lavush hamudot ve'yoshev berosh hakahal. Let's say the son was wearing, you know, respectful clothing, and he was standing on the head of the table, right, with the kahal, with the community, right? Exactly, something like that. So it comes, right? Uvao aviv ve'imo ve'kar'u begadav. So his father or mother came and they tore up his clothes, you know? God! You know, they tore it up like this, right? They disgraced him in public like that. You understand? And they hit him on the head, you know, God! You know, like this. And they also spit, you know, poo! Ah, you know, they totally disgraced him like that. So what should he do in a case like that? Don't embarrass them, you know? Whatever they did to you, don't embarrass them. Don't get them back and say, oh, you know, I'll spit on you too. Hey, who are you? You know, this kind of thing, right? Don't embarrass them like that. Ela yishtok, you should be quiet. Your parents just do that like that to you, just be quiet and absorb it. That's the idea, right? Ve'ira min ha-melech malchei melachim she'tzivahu b'chaf. You have to fear HaKadosh Baruch Hu that commanded you to honor your parents. So therefore, don't get them back. Don't take revenge on them, you know, if they did something like that. Okay, very good. Ezeu kavod, of course. So then, what's kavod? What's considered to be kavod? We just talked about ira, right? We talked about ira. So what's kavod? It says the Shulchan Aruch, machilo mashkeu. We have to bring him food and drinks if he needs. You know, let's say, write something, right? I'm fine, thank you.
So
yeah, for you, that's for you. So I thought it was maybe meant for you. Maybe I'll drink it later. You know, there's a question. So if they need food and drinks, let's say, right? You just bought me a drink. Illustration. You did an illustration. Okay. To demonstrate. Okay. So, What's the rule? You have to bring them whatever they need to eat or to whatever they need to drink. You know, let's say you need to go, they need to somebody to go to the supermarket, you know, to shop for them. Right. So go for them, you know. If they can't do it, they don't want to do it by themselves, or they can't. You know what I mean? They don't want to go, or they can't go. So you should go for them, you know, and buy, bring them food from the supermarket, from the restaurant, whatever it is, right? Awesome. Whatever they need, yes, yes, of course, right? So it says also drinks as well, right? Bring in some wine, you know, some whatever they need, whatever they want. Right, malbish machse also, right, to clothe them as well, and to cover them, right? Let's say your father is sleeping, you know, you see he doesn't have a cover, you know, so go cover him, you know, give him kavod. This is the kavod for the father, to cover his body when he's sleeping. He needs a blanket, whatever it is, you know, he fell asleep without a blanket, whatever it is, right, or something like that, or to clothe him also. Let's say he can't put on the jacket, he's too old, you know, so help him to put the jacket, help him to put his socks, you know, whatever it is, right? Don't think, oh, you know, putting his socks is so degrading. Why so degrading? This is your father, you know. What's the big deal? What? Who are you, a king? What? You can't degrade yourself a little bit? That's the idea, right? Very good. We understand. Machnis umotzi. So also, right, if he needs to go somewhere, take him, you know. Drive him. He needs to go to the doctor. He needs to go to the pharmacy. Whatever it is, right? Exactly. All kinds of things like this. Take him in. Take him out. You know, give him a ride. Give him an escort. This kind of thing, right? Most important thing is when you do this, right, do it with a nice attitude. Don't be nasty, you know, and start like, you know, I don't have time now, I gotta go, you know, you're bothering me, blah, blah. Okay, I'll go, but you know, really, you shouldn't ask me for that. This is the way you respect your father like that, you know, telling him things like this. I can't do it now, I'm busy, blah, blah, blah. What busy? What busy are you? How are you busy? You have to do now, you have to honor your father. Don't tell him you're busy. Right? If you're learning Torah, it's a little bit different, but the truth is, you know, if it's a one-time thing, you mean what, not all the time that it bothers you when you're learning. Let's say one time he told you, listen, you know, so you should stop learning and do the mitzvah. Because if there's nobody else to do it, there's nobody else. Maybe there's another son who can do it, you know, that's something else. But if there's no other son besides you, nobody can do it right now, everybody's, you know, outside or working, whatever it is, right? So you got to do it, don't hesitate. But the most important thing is what? That don't do it with a bad attitude. You know, because you lose this heart of the mitzvah like that. You know, for instance, let's say, right, your father tells you, listen, go bring me some dinner. Don't bring me, some food. So he goes and brings him the food, you know, and he tells him, here, eat, old man, you know, but, you know, bebero, you know, much, I'm a bebero. You know, this is how you talk to your father. You know, old man, you know. Hey, eat, old man, you know.
Yeah, I got something
for you. I got some food for you, you know, old man, you know. Come on, you know, let's go, sit down. Disrespect him like that. They say, if you bring him the food, but you disrespect him, so you lose the schar of the mitzvah. You lose the merit of the mitzvah. Yeah? So the attitude is what, you know, makes it right. Exactly. That's the idea. That's what makes it count. How you do it with a good attitude, with a smile, with a positive attitude. You know, that's the idea. It has to be in a respectful way. Very good.
No, that's a lot different.
So he says, even if it says in Shulchan Aruch that even if he gives it to him whatever he wants, but he does it with an ugly face, you know, with a frown, you know, regret, you know. So he's punished on that. Even though he did kibud avim, he's punished because he treated him not nice. That's the idea, you understand? So a person has to be very careful about that. So says the Ramah over here, the opposite also applies. What does that mean? Sometimes a person can do something which a father is like, it's not really good for him. Let's say, for instance, right, the father got, you know, some mail, and got some mail, and over there, I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens.
So you're here, right?
Yes.
I'm going to be leaving by then. I'm not staying.
You stay, right?
Not after 7:30, no.
When you leaving, what time?
7:30, I'm out of here.
Okay, 7:30, I see.
All the best, Yasha. Come, sit down, join us, Yasha. Sal midichar. Okay, all of us. Okay. So, okay. So, as we said, the person has to give kavod to his parents, but he has to do it with a proper attitude. So, as it says the Ramah, the opposite can also apply. Let's say the father got some kind of a call, you know, from a bill collector. He got a call from a bill collector, he got a call from somebody, you know, he owes money. Right? So, now he's going to go tell his father, you know, something bad news, you know. Oh, you know, they're suing you. You know, so what should he do, right? He has to tell him because he needs to know about that.
Right.
But he should tell him in a nice way, you know, tell him, you know, Abba, you know, I'm sorry to tell you, but, you know, they're suing you, you know, they have to take care of this. So what does that mean? If you do it in a nice way, even though you're giving him bad news, so it's considered to be like kavod. Why? Because you're giving him something that he needs, even though it's something bad, but you're doing it in a very nice way, in a very respectful way, in a merciful way, right, in a good-hearted way. That's the idea, right? That's, so it really matters how the attitude, how you do it. That's the idea. Very good. So as we said, right, that when it comes to kibud av v'em, really the expenses comes from the father, according to halacha, right? Yeah. That's the idea. So it says over here the Shulchan Aruch in Sif Hei that let's say, for instance, if the father has, as we said, he should pay for it, kibud av v'em. He should pay for it. But let's say he doesn't have. So then, right, we tell the son, listen, you know, give it, if you have, pay for it, yeah, and it's going to be like tzedakah for you, you know, like just like you give tzedakah. Mm-hmm. You know, they say, right, chesed matchil babayit, you know, the kindness starts at home. What does that mean? If you can't give your father tzedakah when he needs it, then what are you giving to other people? Yeah, you know what I mean? First give to your father, you know what I mean? That's the idea. That's it, right? That's the idea. So, you should first give to your father, you know, if he needs it. Don't say, oh, you know, that's my father. I can't give my father tzedakah. Why not? You have no choice. I have to give him tzedakah. That's the idea, right? He doesn't have.
You support the father.
Exactly.
Okay.
Very good. So, what does that mean? That it tells you the Shulchan Aruch that let's say if the father is, let's say the father has no money. Pensionary, you know, a poor guy, you know, he doesn't have money. And the son is like, you know, the businessman doing good, you know? Good. So, he should support his father. You know, if he can't support himself, he is the first one he should support is his father before he supports other people. Mm-hmm. Because this is a part of the kibud av v'em as well.
Yes.
Very good. But he says also another thing, which is that what? Ve'im en leben eno chayav lachazir al ptachim le'achil et aviv. Let's say also that if the father doesn't have, the son doesn't have. He doesn't have the son, right? The father doesn't have, the son doesn't have. They're both like poor, you know? So he's not obligated to go and, you know, collect tzedakah, right, exactly. Begging to support his father. That's not allowed.
It says in the
Gemara,
if it's a girl and boy, the boy should go and not the girl, because it's a
very good, very good. Yes. It's a similar case, right. Very good.
Page 54. I'm a little bit wrong.
But tells you, Shulchan Aruch, aval chayav lechabedo begufo. But he is obligated to honor him with his body. Not with his money, but with his body, yes. What does that mean? Go here, do this, do that, right? Go do this for me. Go buy something from me, right? Go to the store for me, go here for me, to the pharmacy, whatever it is. With his body, he's obligated to honor him. Even though it's going to buttle him from his work, right, by doing that. And then he's going to have to collect for himself money because he doesn't have. But that's only when he has money for that day to support himself. But if he doesn't, then he's not obligated to battle his work, to stop his work. Why is that? Because he needs that to eat today. You know, so then he's not obligated to do that. That's the idea. Okay, we shouldn't see from these kinds of things, right? We shouldn't see from these things. Today this is not so common, these kinds of things. Okay, very good. Let's go on a little bit. Chayav la'amod bifnei aviv, right? Another thing is you have to stand up before your father. When you see your father, you got to stand up already, whenever it is, right? So,
like rabbi when he walks in.
By the way, this also applies if it comes even several times a day, according to the Sephardi custom. Let's say he passes by you 20 times, you know? Each time you got to stand up, according to the Sephardi custom.
That's the idea, right? About rabbi Nasi.
Yeah, all kinds of things like that. Yeah. But for your father, how do you have to stand up? Time, all the way, not halfway, you know, like this, you know. A little kidur, he do it. What he do? What he do? You have to stand up all the way.
How much for mom?
Same thing. There's no less than for the mom than it's for the father, right?
What if they say don't do it, then you're forgiven?
Who tells you not to do it? Oh, yeah, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about that, by the way, this issue, what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So, remind me to talk about that.
Yeah, sure. No worries.
Very good. So, according to the Ashkenazim, they're a little bit more lenient. What does that mean? They say you don't have to get up more than twice. You know?
Yeah.
This is the idea. Okay, let's go on. So now it tells you Shulchan Aruch like this, right? Sif Ched. How far does it go, honoring your parents? How far does it go? So it says, Ad hechan kiuda vehem, afilu natlu kis shel zehuvim shelo, even if they took his money, right, exactly, kis, purse, you know, purse full of money, he threw it into the water, you know, gadaglo, you know, lo yachlimem, the shuk, don't embarrass them, and lo yitzarei letzah bifnehem, and don't start, you know, disgracing them, and, you know, arguing with them, ולא יכעוס כנגד them, and don't get angry, you know, with them, אלא יקבל גזרת הכתוב, וישתוק, accept the decree of Hashem and be quiet. But even though they cause you to be like, to lose your mind like this, you see, they threw your money into the sea. This usually doesn't happen, but even if this happens, the person has to still
the
he still has to keep his kavod.
You can throw in the street.
You understand what I mean?
Yes. You can throw in the street.
Okay. Very good.
Money is tough.
So tell us the Shulchan also another thing. What was your question again? The question you asked?
Which one?
Just now.
Is it the money?
I wanted to deal with that.
Ah, with the parents. With the parents.
Yeah, what was the question?
If they come in and walk in, you have to get up unless they tell you don't get up.
Okay, so the truth is right like this, right? That when it comes to Mechila, if your father forgives you and tells you, listen, you know, I don't want you to get up. So you don't have to.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly, right, exactly. Mm-hmm. So he tells you, listen, you know, I don't want you to get up for me. Just sit down, relax, you know. So you should do what he tells you. Why? Because he wants that. That's what he wants. Right? So they say, right, there's a rule like this in halakha. You know what it is? It says, Retzono shel adam hu kevodo. You know what I mean? In other words, his will, that's a kavod. He doesn't want, so do it the way he wants. That's the idea, right? When you do it the way he wants, that's the kavod that he wants. This is his kavod. So therefore, if he tells you not to do it, don't do it. You know what I mean?
If I don't have a chance to do respect.
So what does that mean? There's a rule in halakha like this, right? Av shemachal. Kivado machul, right? Kivado machul.
Melech is not machul.
Right, exactly. Melech is not machul. What's the difference between Melech and father, the king and the father? The king, because his fear has to be on everybody. So therefore, it's not machul. Everybody has to be afraid of him because not to do sins, not to do sins. You understand? Right. But when it comes to the father, since it's not like that, so therefore, if he forgives you, you're allowed to be, you're allowed to exempt yourself from this kind of thing.
Huh?
Can you close that door? I'm sorry.
Call.
No, because of the noise. Okay, so.
You want water? A glass of water?
No, I'm fine.
Okay. I'm listening.
So, questions like this, right? Let's say, this happens, by the way, very often.
Yes.
Let's say a person has old parents. And they now have a little bit senile, you know?
Yeah.
Became senile.
They don't
have a straight head. They're, you know, they can't react properly, they can't treat you properly. They're like, you know, they lose their patience, they yell at you all the time.
Right.
You know, irrational behavior. And that's the idea, right? So the question is, what do you do in a case like that where it's hard to take care of them?
Yeah.
Because they're mentally already, you know, ill, you know, they're not 100%. You know what I mean? So what do you do in a case like that?
Find the respect as much as you can.
So says the Shulchan Aruch like this, right? Mishtatel linhog imahem kefi datam ad sheyerucham alehem. Right? So it says, try to treat them with respect. Have a seat, join us. Try to treat them with respect anyway, right? Until Hashem will have mercy on them and
they'll be
okay. Right, exactly. That's the idea. So if that happened to them, let's say it happens sometimes that a parent is like, you know, he lost his mind. Went crazy, you know? That's the idea, right? So what happens is that what do you do with them in a case like that? Try to treat them with kavod anyway, if you can, you know, if it's possible. Because sometimes it's very difficult to do that.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Sometimes it's like, it becomes unbearable.
But if you argue with people, with parents, or you scream at them, that's
one thing at a time. Let's first understand this, right? Ve'im e'efshar lo lamod, and if he cannot do it, let's say, right, it's too hard for him.
Right.
You know? They're making him crazy, they're making him nuts. You can't tolerate anymore.
Yeah,
so what do you do in a case like that?
Leave the house.
Right? So what is it? Mipnei they got went really crazy. Yelech lo v'anichem. So leave them, he says. You know, just leave them. V'itzaver le'acharim le'nahagam k'rawi. And appoint other people to take care of them. Professionals, you know? People who can take care of this kind of... Right, home attendant or nursing home, you know, things like this. Whatever it is, right?
Nursing home. All kinds of things. Like you drop them.
Sometimes you have to do that. You have no choice. Because, you know, they're not normal. You know what I mean? So sometimes you gotta take it to an institution. To, you know what I mean? You know? There's no choice. What can you do? You know? What can you do? You can't take care of him. He's gonna kill you. You know, he's gonna, he yells at you, screams at you all the time, you know, hits you, throws things at you, you know. So what are you gonna do? Take care of him like that? Sometimes it could be too difficult. So if it's too difficult for you, leave him for somebody professional to take care of him. You know, appoint somebody, somebody to take care of him. That's the idea. Very good. So now the question is like this, right? Ra'abib Shavar al Divrei Torah. Let's say he saw his father that he transgressed a certain
avera. Then you have to rebuke him.
What do you have to tell him? Right? He says, "No yomar lo avarta al divrei Torah." Don't tell him, "Oh, you did a sin." You know, hatata avita pashata. You know what I mean? Don't tell him like that. This is disrespectful. So what should you tell him? Tell him, "Ela yomar lo abba katuv b'Torah kach v'kach." Tell him, "Abba, you know, it's written in the Torah like this." Don't tell him you did sin. Tell him, you know, don't you? You know, it's written like this. You remember that? Remember you taught me? One day, it's written like that. That's the idea, right? Keduhu shoel mimenu, like he's asking him, you know, is that true? It's written like that, no, in the Torah? No, so then he'll remember that he's doing something wrong. That's the idea, right? But don't tell him, oh, you know, Abba, you're a sinner, you know? It's disrespectful. You sinned, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm not telling him like that. That's the idea. Very good. So the question is like this, right? Shulchan Aruch says, "Amar lo aviv." Let's say his father told him, "Hashkeni maim," you know, bring me water, you know, like you did. So ve'yesh lefanav la'asot mitzvah overet, and he has also mitzvah overet, another mitzvah that he has to do, which is going to be like the time is limited. If he doesn't do it now, he's going to lose the mitzvah. So which one should he do first, right? So he says, "Im efshar le mitzvah she ta'aseh al di'achrim," if somebody else can do that mitzvah. So then he should do for his father first, if somebody else can do that mitzvah. Understand? But if there's nobody else to do it, right? So then what do? Yasok mitzvah, v'aniach kavod aviv. Do first the mitzvah, and then leave the father for later. Right, exactly. For Hashem. Hashem comes first. That's the idea, right? So, you know, there are some agadot about this, what you're saying, right?
Yeah.
There are some agadot. What does it say in the agadah? It says that, why does it say, dafka, when it says, mm-hmm. It says first the father and then the mother. But when it says, ish imo ba'aviv tirau, over there it says the mother first.
Right.
Why does it say over there the mother first and over here the father first? That's the question,
it's
right?
It's the opposite.
So the answer is like this. The answer is like this, right? Say the Chazal. The reason is because usually a person, by nature, he honors his mother more than the father. So therefore, it puts the father first to tell you, right? Don't forget your father. Your father is also important. It may be that you love your mother more, but your father also, you have to honor him just like your mother. There's no difference between them. Same way, right? When it comes to fear, it says just the opposite, right? That what? But usually, a person fears his father more than his mother. Why is that? Because he teaches him Torah, you know? He's more scary, the father. You know what I mean? So therefore, he usually fears his father more. So it tells you that you have to fear your mother also. What does that mean? Don't think that your mother is any less than the father. You also have to fear your mother, even though she's a lady. You know, nobody fears ladies, you know? Nobody fears women. But
it's the opposite.
Right, so exactly. So it comes to remind you, you also have to fear your mother as well. That's the idea, right? That's the idea.
I understand, of course.
Very good.
More respect of the mom. Yeah.
There you go.
The father. Zupro Isan. Street.
So the question is like this. Like, now we just talked about that. So now let's say comes to you, your father, and tells you, give me water. And then your mother also told you, give me water. Who do you have to give first?
Your
mother or your father?
Father.
Why is that?
No,
that's not the reason. The reason is like this, right? The reason why you have to give your father first is because she's also obligated to honor your father. You know, the wife has to honor the husband. So therefore, since the wife is also obligated, where does it say, by the way, that the wife has to honor the husband? Where does it say in the Torah? Huh? So you know what it is? It's from the Chachamim. The Chachamim made this. Right? The Chachamim made a rule that it says in the Rambam.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That what? He got the shoot. That the wife has to honor the husband. So therefore, since she's also obligated to another husband as well, this is the reason why it tells you...
respect the father.
Exactly. That's the idea. What does it tell you? That you got to do the father first, because his honor is bigger in that case. But that's only when. That's only when they're married, right? But let's say, for instance, they got divorced. So then if they got divorced, is she obligated to honor him? No more, right? That's it. The honor is already finished. So therefore, since she's not obligated to honor him, so then who do you give first? Whoever you want. Whoever you want. Why is that? Because not one of them has more honor than the other. This is the idea. Very good. Another interesting scenario is like this, right? Let's say his father told him to transgress the words of the Torah. Tells him, listen, you know, go and break Shabbat, right? Drive on Shabbat. Tells you like this. Right? Did you listen to him? That's the question, right? Ben mitzvah, taseh, ben mitzvah, taseh. Whatever it's, aseh, positive mitzvah or negative mitzvah, afilo mitzvah should depend. Even if the rabbanan is only from rabbis. Lo yaseh lo. Don't do it, right? Whatever he asks you to do, don't do it. Why is that? Because everybody's obligated to honor Hashem. You, your father, and your mother, all are obligated to honor Hashem. So therefore, this is the reason why a person has to first give honor to Hashem. The honor of Hashem comes first. And then if there's something left over, honor also your parents. But if it's something which contradicts the Torah, which goes against the halakha, so you tell your father, I'm sorry, but you know, this is against the Torah, I cannot do that. You know? Or your mother, the same thing, right? First, I have to honor Hashem. We all have to honor Hashem. You and me, right? And the mother as well. That's the idea.
Okay.
So another interesting point, right, makes over here, the Shulchan was like this. Av shetzivah et beno, shelo yedaber im ploni. Let's say your father told you, don't talk to this person. You know, this guy's a bad guy. Don't talk to him. You have to listen to him? That's the question, right?
Listen. The father knows.
Don't answer. All right? So it says like this, right? ושלא ימחול לו עד זמן קצוב והבן היה רוצה להתפייס but the son doesn't want to do that. He wants to make up with this guy. He doesn't want to fight with him. You know, the father tells him, don't make up with him, don't be friends with him, but this guy wants to be friends. So what's the rule, right? אין לו לחוש לצוואתו. So here you don't have to listen to your father. Why is that, by the way? Can you know the reason? You know what the reason is? Because in a case like that, since the father is telling him something which has nothing to do with him, what does that have to do with you, you know? What? If I have to help you, I'll help you. But this, talking with this person has nothing to do with you. It doesn't help you. So therefore, this is the reason why a person doesn't have to listen. So the rule is like this, right? There's a general rule like that. If the father tells you or the mother tells you something which has nothing to do with them, doesn't help them, you don't have to listen to them. You only have to listen to something which it helps them, they need it, that they need it for themselves. So what does that mean? Let's say the father tells you, listen, you know, I have a friend. Go and help my friend, you know? Mm-hmm. So you don't have to go help his friend. Why is that? Because you don't have to help him, what he needs.
Mm-hmm.
But to help his friend, you're not obligated to do that. That's the idea, you know what I'm saying?
If you're respecting your father, you listen to him.
So in a case like that, you don't have to listen.
Okay.
So the same thing also applies, by the way, let's say, for instance, right, there's all kinds of interesting cases like this. Let's say your father told you, you know, listen, I don't like the way your hair is. Go get a haircut, you know? Mm-hmm. You have to listen to that? You don't have to listen. Why is that? Because it has nothing to do with him. You have to do things which are pertinent to him. You know? Your haircut is your business, you know, the way you want your hair. But let's say he tells you, listen, I don't like the way you dress. Go buy some new clothes. You don't have to listen to that. Why is that? Because it has nothing to do with him, you know? What does that have to do with you? What does it have to do with you? I have to help you what you need. You can't tell me how to live my life. What does it have to do? One with the other. I'm not connected, you understand? That's the idea. Very good. Same thing also, by the way, applies in a case where, let's say, the guy wants to get married, right, the son, right, wants to get married, and the father tells him, this girl is no good, don't marry her, you know? Or the mother tells him, right, don't marry that girl, she's a lowlife. But the guy likes her, you know? So what's halakha? Halakha is you can marry her. Why is that? Because it has nothing to do with them. What does it have to do with you? It's my business.
Maybe they're
who
right.
I marry, you know what I mean?
Maybe they're right, though.
Huh?
If she's not good for you.
Oh, that's a good question. If they're right, you should listen to them. You know why? Because you should listen to anybody who's right. You should listen to anybody's right, for sure, right? All the more so your parents. If they're really right, the person is no good, you should listen to them. But in a case where a person is, you think that the person is okay. You like this person, you know? Even though your parents don't like him. So the rule is you can marry him even though, right? The same thing applies with the girl as well, by the way. Let's say they tell the girl, the daughter, right? Don't marry this guy, you know? She doesn't have to listen to them. If she likes this guy, she can go and marry him. That's the idea. Very good. So tells the Shulchan Aruch, it's an interesting thing, right? That when it comes to honoring your parents, the son and the daughter have the same obligation. Doesn't matter whether you're a girl or you're a boy. Same thing. But there's an interesting thing to understand about that. Which is that what? That the woman is different, though. How is it different? You know why? You know why? Because once she gets married, the obligation of honoring her parents is already absolved. It's already batel. It's already canceled.
The husband is boss.
Exactly. Now she has to honor her husband. Exactly. So since she has to honor her husband, she has the honor of her husband now on her back, on her shoulders. So therefore, now she's no more obligated to honor her parents. So what does that mean? Let's say she's married, right? Let's say she's married. And the father tells her, you know, oh yeah, go do this for me. But she needs to do something now for her husband, to make dinner for him, right? So she has to first make dinner for her husband. And then ask the husband, you know, can I go to do something for my father? If he allows her, then he can go. But if he needs her for something, she has to do first for her husband. Yeah. That's the idea, you know? So therefore, once a woman gets married, the mitzvah of kibud avim already gets canceled. Unless the husband allows it, or there's time, you know, husband is not home, let's say, but whatever. He doesn't need now to be helped with something. And the house is okay, everything's okay. So then she can go and honor her parents. But if the husband needs now something from her, she's not allowed to go. That's the idea, right? Unless the husband is mocher, you know? He says, okay, go, you know? Go and do it. I forgive you.
Unless he gives him permission.
You understand? Very good. But when it comes to morad and fearing the parents, that stays with her all her life. Why? Because that has nothing to do with her husband. To treat them with respect, not to disrespect them, that always applies. Right? As we said, right? Two different things. Morah, fear, and kibud, right? That's something, two different things. So when it comes to kibud, she's absolved when it comes to honoring. But when it comes to morah, when it comes to fear, she still has a mitzvah to fear her parents. So what does that mean? If her father walks in the room, she still has to stand up, even if she's married. Has nothing to do, right, with the... You know what I mean? That's the idea. Whatever... I'm sorry?
For husband.
No, she doesn't have to understand. No,
they're equal.
Not they're not equal. But the point is, right, that the rabbis did not go so far to obligate her to stand for her husband. Right. That's the idea.
Okay.
Very good.
Right.
Another interesting thing is like this. Right? We talked last week about the issue of Mamzer. A person who's Mamzer. Illegitimate child. Mm-hmm. So the question is he obligated to honor his father? Even though he brought him into the world, he brought him into the world with sin.
Yes, yes.
You know? So, are you obligated to honor your father like that? That's the question. So it says in the Shulchan, he's still obligated to honor him. Can you imagine? Even though his father is a sinner, he's not a good person. Rashakya, you know, Ubedur, you know? He's a Rasha. Nevertheless, he has to honor him anyway.
Mamzer has to honor his father?
Exactly. Can you imagine? It goes that far.
Mamzer should honor Yari to honor.
Whatever it is, he is. That's a little bit different, right? That's it. Mamzer means that, you know, there was a sin that he came with a sin, you know, from the sin. That's the idea, right? We talked about that last week. Look in my lecture over there, you'll see. On YouTube, you'll find it over there. It's Facebook. So that's the idea from last Thursday. You'll see it over there. About Mamzer, about all the things about Mamzer. So as we said, right, but there is also an exception with that. So what does that mean? That it says in the halakha that a person, let's say his father is a sinner, you know?
Right.
He shaves with a razor, you know? Let's say he eats at McDonald's, you know, goes to McDonald's, eats over there, right? All kinds of dunk kosher. Right? Oh yeah, steals, right, exactly. Gezel. So are you obligated to honor your father if he's a sinner? So it's a machloket between the Rambam and the tour, right? The Rambam says you're obligated to honor him, even though he's a sinner. Why is that? Because one day he may do tshuva, you know, this kind of thing, you understand? So therefore, we say, yeah, you know, that you never know what's going to be, right? He may do tshuva one day. So therefore, and he also may have thoughts here, hure tshuva, thoughts of tshuva. He's thinking about tshuva. So they say if a person is thinking about tshuva, sometimes he's forgiven, you know? Vidui, you know, all kinds of things. You know, vidui shebelev. So therefore, but the tour says, no, he's not obligated. If he's a sinner, the father's not obligated. So Ashkenazim, the Ramah, goes like the tour, not obligated, right? Because right now he's a Rasha, you know? What do I care what's going to be tomorrow? You know what I mean? Today, now he's a Rasha. That's the idea. So therefore, the tour says you're not obligated. But the Rambam says you are. So now the question is like this, right? What about the issue where, let's say your father, not only is a Rasha, but he's Mechalel Shabbat, you know, before Hesia, you know? He breaks Shabbat in public. He drives his car, right? So over there are some Sfarim, let's say, like the Or HaChaim HaKadosh and the Aruch HaShulchan. They said if he breaks Shabbat, but same thing also if he does Avodah Zarah, you know, things like this, you're not obligated to honor him at all. Like, even the Rambam would agree. You know why? Because they say, right, that exactly, a person who desecrates Shabbat in public, or one who does Avodah Zarah, is considered to be like he's breaking all the sins. He's like a goy, you know? He's like a goy. So therefore, this is the reason why.
Huh? If he breaks it by
so tell him, if he did it by mistake, tell him, you know? But if he does it all the time, you know, he does it all the time. It's not a mistake. He knows what he's doing. He does it all the time like that. So he doesn't do tshuva. So therefore, the rule is, right, in a case like that, they say that you don't have to honor your father or mother if they're breaking Shabbat in public like that.
That's for me.
But the truth is that there are some who say, Maran Rav Avadia, you know what he says in Yevi Omer? He says over there that even if it's their Mechalel Shabbat, the parents, you should still try to honor them a little bit. What does that mean? In other words, respect them, you know? Well, you know why that is? Because by respecting them, you bring them closer to Hashem. Especially nowadays, you know, people are considered Tinok Shenishba. They're doing it like, you know, without really knowing what they're doing. They don't know. Most people are breaking Shabbat. They don't know that it's so bad to break Shabbat. So therefore, since they don't understand all these things, this is the reason why the Maran says, the Rabbi says, Hashem, even though they're breaking Shabbat, respect them, you know, because this way you bring them close. You know, but the truth is that, technically speaking, from the Torah, probably you're not obligated to honor them. So there is no obligation, technically, but treat them with respect to bring them close.
They don't know so much and break it.
So it's considered to be like Tinok Shenishba, you know? That's the idea, right? That's the reason why we say that you should try to treat them with respect if you can. But the truth is that if a person did something bad to his father, let's say, right? He disrespected him.
Yes.
And his father is Mechalel Shabbat. So he's not really, you know, he's not really obligated so much. But the truth is, you know, nevertheless, no matter what, Poskim say, you know what they say to Poskim? They said, Poskim, even if you're not obligated to honor your father, let's say, because he's Mechalel Shabbat, he breaks Shabbat. But nevertheless, if you disgrace him, you know, like embarrass him, disgrace him, you know, say something really bad to him, insult him, you know, embarrass him in public, you know, tell him, like, scream at him, yell at him. So things like that you're never allowed to do to your father. No matter is keeping Shabbat or not keeping Shabbat. So what does that mean? To honor them is one thing, you know, to bring them food, to bring them all kinds of things. Okay, maybe you're not obligated with that because he's Mechalel Shabbat, he doesn't keep Shabbat. But when it comes to disgracing them, like, you know, embarrassing them, yelling at them, screaming at them. No, this you're not allowed to do any time to any father or any mother. Because this is considered to be something really, really
important.
And this, by the way, also another thing, that they cannot be mochel on this, your parents. Your parents can be mochel on their kavod, on their honor. They can forgive you. You don't have to stand up for me. You don't have to do this for me. Okay, they can. But when it comes to disgracing them, bizayon, there's no mechila for that. So what does that mean? A person who disgraces his parents like that, he's going to be punished. No matter what, even if here and there, everywhere. Why is that? Because even if they were mochel, even if they forgave him, it still doesn't absolve him. That's the idea. So a person should never do that. That's the idea. You know what I mean? Okay, very good. Another important halacha is like this, right? It says in Shulchan Aruch that a person is not allowed to also, as a father, you know, you should be zocha b'ezrat Hashem to have children.
Amen.
You know, be a father. So what I say is like this, right? You shouldn't also burden them, the children, too much. You know, ask them, do this for me, do that for me. You know, make them crazy. You know, all the time asking them to do this because they can't do so much. And you're gonna cause them to sin like that. Mm-hmm. You understand? So they say, be careful. You know, don't make your children crazy.
So
you know, like putting too much pressure on them. You know, why aren't you doing this? Do this. You know, making them crazy. So you're causing them to sin like that because they can't do all the things that you ask them to do. So what does that mean? If you see that a child is very rebellious, right? Exactly, is a little bit rebellious and not so doesn't honor you so much. Don't you know? Be easy with him. You know, don't burden him too much. And also, there's another thing, you know, which is good advice, by the way. Mm-hmm. Put down the poskim. You know, what's brought down? It says like this, right? That when a person sees that his child turns bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah, you should say, you know, tell him like this, right? Ani mochel. I'm mochel on kibud avim. Why is that? Because just in case they don't do something the right way, they shouldn't be punished for it.
You
understand?
Especially with girl 12.
Another interesting thing it says like this, right? Hamaket livno gadol menadin oto. A person as a father is not allowed to hit a child who's grown up already. Right? Grown up. A child who's grown up. Not allowed to hit them. You know why? Because it causes them to rebel. They're already a grown person. It's a grown son. It's a grown daughter. You're hitting them now, it's going to cause them to get even worse. So therefore, right, they say we excommunicate him. We put him in nidui.
Ah, to the father.
To the father, because he hits his grown-up child.
Did they hit him?
So,
Meradin, what does it mean?
Meradin? Yeah. That means nidui, right? Cherem, you know?
Ah, nidui.
Machalimim oto.
I thought they hit him.
No, that's nothing else. So.
No.
Okay.
No.
Zen, this is Malkot. Malkot, it's Moshe. Malkot. Okay, so anyway, right, as it says, by the way, the poskim in our times, you know what they say, the Ritva. He says, Ritva was already 700 years ago. He says the Ritva, Elashvili, right. He says the Ritva that if you see that a person, a son, is already like not so old, but he's rebellious, you know, he doesn't listen to you anymore. So they say also you shouldn't hit him either. You know why? Because when you hit him, it's going to cause him to rebel more. So if you see a son who doesn't listen to you anymore, you know, say, but don't hit. You know what I mean? Because if you hit him, it's going to cause him to get worse. Rebuke him, you know? Darige, you know? You tell him some wisdom, you know? Why do you do this? Why do you do that? Tell him, you know, the truth about things. But don't be too rough with him. You know what? Because it's going to cause him to rebel. Even if they're small, you know, they say, right, he told us, if you see a small child, even if he's like, let's say, 8 years old, nine years old, and you see that when you hit him, he gets rebellious, you know, he hits you back. You know, it tells you, he starts going crazy, you know, on you. Right? So they say, don't hit him anymore. You know why? Because you see that the child is rebellious. You understand? So now just, you know, deal with him with verbally, you know, just verbal rebuke. Sometimes that doesn't even work either, by the way. But whatever it is, right? Whatever you can do, you can do. Whatever you can do. But the point is, like, don't cause him by too much rebuke, too much hitting, that he's going to rebel against you. Because that's going to get even worse. This is the idea. Very good. Okay. Let's go on.
How long?
What time is it?
7:22.
Another 10 minutes.
Thanks for the day, Victoria.
God bless you. It's good for you, you know? You need to know these things.
Yeah, I know something. You look like Donna Barbanel. In a way, don't be offended. In books, you know? Seriously.
Okay. Very good. Another interesting halakha is like this, right? Yeah. Let's say if the father or the right wants to give to the son some service, you know, bring him a drink, bring him some food. You know, you understand? Yeah, the father wants to give to the son. So the question is, are you allowed to take it from him or is it considered to be disrespectful? That's the idea, right? So it says like this, right, in Shulchan Aruch. You're allowed to take from him service. Unless what?
Scholar.
Unless he's a Ben Torah, right? If he's a Talmid Chacham, or you know somebody who studies Torah a lot, this kind of thing, right? He's a Torah person, you know, Chacham, you know. So there, you're not allowed to take.
Disrespectful.
Can you imagine? You're not allowed to take service from him. Why is that? Because it's a disgrace to the Torah, you know, that you're taking from your father. He's also like you know your teacher. He teaches you Torah, even if he's not teaching you, but he's a rabbi, you know. Let's say he's a Talmid Chacham. So you're not going to take from him. That's the idea, right? Mm-hmm. So you see from there how the Chachamim, they were very makpid about this.
Yes.
That what? That you have to treat your parents with kavod, even though you're not doing nothing, they're doing it for you. What about if the mother wants to give you kavod, right? To bring you some food? That's the derech, you know, it's a way to do that. She's not a Talmid Chacham. She's not a rabbi. So therefore, in a case like that, you're allowed to, exactly, let's say the, you know, case like that, when your mother serves you, right? She serves everybody in the family. So what, you're not going to take from her? And that's not normal, right? That's not, you know what I mean? But your father, if he's a chacham, you're not allowed to take service from him. That shows you, by the way, all the more so, if your father is a chacham, don't ask him to do things for you, you know? Oh, go take me over here, take me, do this for me, do that for me. Don't ask him to do things for you because you're like using him, a tamishtamesh. Tamishtamesh with tamish chacham, you know?
That's life, maybe, that's me.
You understand? All the more so if you're not allowed to take service from him, course you can, you're not allowed to ask him to do something for you. You know what I mean?
How about brothers?
Unless you have no choice. You know, if you have no choice.
Your brother is older than you, and he's a scholar.
Yeah, for the brother it's allowed. For the brother it's allowed. For the brother it's allowed.
Okay.
Very good. So let's say a couple of things about Kibud Av Ve'Em, right? Mm-hmm. Now that the interesting thing is like this, right?
Yes.
There's a lot of stories brought down about this, by the way, about Kibud Av Ve'Em honoring your parents. So one of the interesting things is that the Chazon Ish said something interesting, right? Chazon Ish, Al Hashanah. He said, the Chazon Ish, that if you want to marry a girl, right? If you want to get married, and you want to see if she's a good girl or a bad girl, you know? You want to see what her character is? How do you see her character? You know, today they know how to hide everything to these people, you know?
Uh-huh.
They know how to hide their character. They come and show you, you know, that they're righteous and pristine, but they're really not so righteous. You understand? So how do you know if a person is really righteous or not?
He says Rashi,
a woman is righteous.
You have to look at the brother, who your brother is also.
Oh, that's very good, what you're saying, right? But let's say, for instance, right, you can, there is no brother or whatever, right?
Yeah,
so how do you tell if she's a good girl or not? Right? That's the idea. So sometimes, by the way, it doesn't apply to the brother. You know why? Let's say she did tshuva. You know what I mean? And the brother still didn't do tshuva. So you can't really go by the brother. She's different than the brother. You know what I mean? So then what do you do in a case like that? So it says the Chazon Ish, what you do is like this, right? You see two things about the girl. You can see if she's a good girl or not, to marry her. Right? One thing is tzniut, and the other one is what? Kibud Aven. That she honors her parents. If you see that she honors her parents, and she's tzanua, you can see that she's going to be a good wife.
What if she's one of the two?
I'll explain to you what that means. I'll answer your question. It means like this, right? It means that a person, why? Because if a girl has those two things, that shows that she's good to Shemayim, she's good, she has God-fearing, because she dresses betzniut. Because the most important mitzvah for the girl is tzniut. You understand? So if she dresses betzniut, that shows that she's a good woman. That's the idea. She's God-fearing. She has irat Shemayim. Ben Adam la-makom, right? Towards God. But what about Kibud Aven? That shows Ben Adam la-chavero, that she honors her parents, and she also treats people with respect, her parents.
Right.
And she's obligated to honor them. So what do you see from there? If you see that she honors her parents, she will also honor the husband as well. That's what the Chazon Ish said, you understand? So if you see those two things, that shows that she's going to be good for irat Shemayim. If she's dressing with tzniut, behaving with tzniut, with modesty, that's the idea, right? And if she honors her parents, that means she's also going to honor her husband as well. Because she honors people who she's obligated to honor them. But if you see that she treats her parents with disrespect, you know, puts her feet up next to the parents, you know, it just sits like that, you know, disrespectful, talks to them in chutzpah. So she's going to do the same thing to her husband.
No.
This is the idea, you understand? That's how you tell the character of a person, a woman, you want to marry. That's what the husband says. It's a very good advice, right?
No.
So what do you see from there? That a person who has kibud aven, right, that means he's a tzaddik, he's a God-fearing person. You can tell by how he treats, you know, his parents. That means he's going to treat you also good. Everybody's going to treat good.
But if the father is not here,
that's the idea. You know, there was a story like this where they say, the Chazon Ish, I know what you mean, but you should call them, you know, once in a while. Go to visit them also.
No, my parents said, don't call them.
Go visit them. You're obligated to do that. You know, even if they tell you not to do it, don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. You know, speak with the father and ask him if he wants.
Okay.
If he doesn't want, that's something else, right? That's a different story.
Right,
exactly. That's the idea. So, what do we see from there? Right, there was a case like this. They say, one time they came to Chazon Ish. They asked him about this lesson that he gave. They asked him, there's a girl that she honors her parents too much. You know, like she's crazy about them. She like, you know, does everything for them. You know, like a maidservant. You know, so they were worried that if I marry a girl like this, you know, she won't honor the husband. She'll always honor her parents. You know, be crazy about them and not honor the husband. So you know what the Chazon Ish answered? He said, no, it's not true. If she honors her parents, she's going to be the same way with the husband. So you don't have to be afraid of that. So what does that mean? You see from there that if a woman has this characteristic of honoring her parents, she will also honor her husband.
Yeah.
Because that means that she respects authority.
But it's important.
Exactly. It's important regarding Klapei Shemaya, you know? Regarding the heavens, right? Ben Adam l'makom, right? Man to God. When it comes to man to man, Ben Adam l'chavero, so over there you see by tzniut, that's the idea. That's the way it works. Baruch Adonai Le'olam. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming. God bless you. You should be zochem b'ezras Hashem to honor your parents and your children should honor you. Refuah shlema, osher v'chavod, chaim tovim, arukim, chupa b'ezras Hashem b'mehera v'ameinu, yiladim tovim, tzadikim. Amen. Amen. Chazak baruch tihyeh. Tevorach. Thanks for coming. God bless you. All the best. Oh. There you go. Amen. Amen.